This video is about the IEEE Signal Processing Cup 2021, which is called Configuring an Intelligent Reflecting Surface for Wireless Communications. There is two data sets that are utilized here in order to configure the surface, and your task is to find the best configuration based on the provided data. And to give you some examples of how you can analyze just the most basic properties of this IRS, I've added now two code examples in a folder of that name, and in this video I will walk you through those examples as well. The first example is about the spectrum, how the received signal is separated over different subcarriers. So I am loading the dataset number one, and then I have written here some of the parameters that are stated in the problem. So we have 10 megahertz of bandwidth. The symbol time is 1 over the bandwidth, that is how many symbols per second that we are having. In the dataset, there is something called receive signal 4N. This is when we are transmitting a pilot signal of length 4N, and we are trying to figure out what are the received signal at different times. So that is what have been stored in this vector. And I will now take out the received signal for four different configurations. Number one, number two, number three, and then I have selected 4097 as well. The reason for that is that it happens to be almost the same as the first one, except that in the first one, all of the elements are set to plus one, and in 4097, all of them are set to the minus one configuration. For each of these ones, this is a vector, and we are computing the absolute value square of all the elements and store it in different vectors like this. So these vectors are containing the received signal energy per symbol on each of the K subcarriers. If you would like to transform that into the signal energy per second, which is what we call watt, then we could divide with the symbol time, which is the same thing as multiplying with the bandwidth. So that is what I'm doing here. And next, I am plotting for each of these four configuration over different subcarriers the received signal energy, and I transform it into decibel scale because there are large variations. So this is what this function is doing. And on the horizontal axis, I have the subcarrier index. I have the received power now in dB of watt or dBW. And I do this for all of the four different configurations. Let's run this file. So you can see that for each of the configurations, we have the subcarrier indices here. We have the received power in dB watt, and you see that they are varying a lot up and down. This is due to the channel fading behaviors. And in addition to varying up and down, we see also that they are varying a lot between different configurations. So apparently the IRS configuration have a large impact on the actual performance of the system. And we can see when we're comparing configuration 1 and 4097, which, as I said, one have plus one on everything, one have minus one at everything. Well, they are looking quite different, which means that they are interacting with the direct path in different ways. The second example is about how we can estimate the variance of the noise, which is assumed to be the same on all our 51 receivers. And now dataset 1 is still very useful because it contains additional pilot signals. We can estimate certain things. In particular, we can identify that configuration 1 and configuration 8093 have exactly the same configuration on the IRS. They're all equal to the one configuration. That means that the received signal should be the same thing except for the noise. So if we are taking the received signal for each of these two different configurations and we are computing the difference between them, then what is left should only be noise if everything else in the propagation environment stays fixed. And since we are computing this different, we are taking the noise term in one of them, minus noise terms from the other one, but they are independent of each other. They can be both positive and negative, so they're adding up, you're doubling the variance, and to compensate for that, I'm dividing with the square root of 2 here. So we now have a vector of length k that is containing only noise over all of the subcarriers. And we can now estimate the noise variance over the subcarriers using the function var, and we feed residual noise here as the input. Then we get the variance estimate in energy per symbol. To get a sense of if our variance estimate makes sense or not, we can compare it against theory. We know that the thermal noise at room temperature is -204 dB watt per hertz, which is also often written as -174 dBm per hertz. So this is dB a watt and this is dB a milliwatt. If we should transfer this into energy per symbol watt per hertz, we are going from the decibel scale to the power scale. We take this -204 and transform it, we get the ideal thermal noise variance. And we can compare now our estimate with the ideal thermal noise, compute the difference like this, and that will give us an estimate of the noise amplification. This is something that appears in all kinds of hardware, that the variance of the noise that we are observing is larger than the ideal thermal noise because of amplification inside the receiver hardware. So if we are running this code here, we can now look at the estimate of the noise amplification, which is 7.7 in this case, which gives an indication that the noise variance that we are observing in the receiver hardware is 7.7 times larger than we have in the ideal case with no noise amplification. And this is a reasonable number. We typically have maybe between 5 and 15 decibels. So this is a typical number for that. If we would like to transform our noise variance to power measured in watt, well, just as in the first example, we take our estimate and we divide with the symbol time, which is the same thing as multiplying with the bandwidth, and then we get the variance in watt. The third example is considering how we can configure the surface in a very, very simple way, because I don't want to give away how I would do it because the competition is about this. But just to give you a sense of what one could easily do is to compute the received signal energy for all the configurations. And now we're looking at data set one. And we compute energy per symbol for each configuration on each subcarrier. So we take the absolute value of the received signal and square it. So now on each row, we have the received signal energy on one of the subcarriers. And in each column, we're considering one of the configurations. For each configuration, we can sum up the total received power over all our subcarriers. So then we take this term, we're summing up over the first dimension, namely the rows, which was the different subcarriers. So now we have a variable containing the total amount of energy that we are receiving for each of the different subcarriers, and that is stored in different columns. If you would like to figure out the configuration among those that we have tested that have the strongest total power, we can use the max operator and figure out the strongest total power, the largest value in this vector, and its index. We can also compute the smallest total received power among all our configurations by taking this vector and take out this minimum. Store the smallest total received power and the index of it in this vector. I will end this example by plotting over the subcarriers how the signal power looked like for these two different configurations that we have selected. So I take the received signal energy for the strongest one and for the weakest one, and I divide with the symbol time, so I transform this into energy per second or watt. Then I'm plotting it here over different subcarriers and the power in dB scale. So we are getting the result like this. So for the configuration with the strongest total received power, I get these variations over the frequency domain, measuring the received power in dB watt. And here is the subcarrier indices. And for the weakest one, we have these variations, which looks much more noise-like than here, where we have a clear structure determined by the propagation environment. And if you look at the vertical scales here, we can see that here we are centered around 90 dB watt, and here we have -130 dB watt. So between the best configuration here and the weakest one, we have a 40 decibel difference. So it really makes a big difference what kind of configuration we're having. But by taking out the configuration here that had the strongest total received power, have I solved the whole problem? No, not at all. There are two important things to think about. One is that just because we have the strongest total received power, we see that there is still large variation of the subcarriers. And it is the race over the subcarriers that is the important thing. So it might not be the one that is providing the strongest total received power, but the one that is maximizing the rate over all of different subcarriers. So maybe smaller variations is better than having some that are strong and some that are weak. In addition, I have only considered the configuration now that we were using when we were sending our pilots. And there is almost an infinitely large number of different configurations. So if you can learn the channel a different way, you can maybe figure out another configuration, one that we didn't test during the pilot transmission that would provide us with even better channel conditions. We have now reached the end of these three examples, and I wish you good luck with the rest of the IEEE Signal Processing Cup 2021, and I hope that these three examples will be useful for you to validate what you have done so far and to get some more ideas about what you can do before the submission deadline.